So now what we're going to talk about is a little bit of the IP address basics, and then we'll go into the firewall information. So assuming that we understand IP addresses, and that's the assumption that I'm going to make here, is that you know this already. If they're internal, they're going to be assigned by DHCP. They can be renewed every 24 hours. Now, basically what this means is that IP addresses will change over time. This will be most noticeable if you say, reboot a virtual machine, and then all of a sudden its IP address has changed. In general, not a problem, right? But if you have set other services or other programs to look for this particular IP address, it's not going to resolve anymore. You have to go in and update that. But it's a pretty common, thing that we do. We have dynamically assigned IP addresses, so don't hard bake in predefined known to change IP addresses. That's just bad design anyway. But we do get the notion that the name of the virtual machine is resolvable too. So if we are inside of a VPC network, in general, we can just call the name of the machine and we'll actually get access to it. But that's if we are inside our walled garden of VPC network. If we are outside, this name is not going to be known, right? We have not registered it with a registrar. What we have to do is we have to use the external IP address, which is this guy over here. And again, if we go back to our Compute Engine page, internal, external. By default, both ephemeral. So basically, these will change at least once tw every 24 hours. But depending on how things are going, you might see the same IP address until you reboot it. Just kind of depends on if it gets forced to change or not. But one of the things you can do with external IPs is that you can actually reserve them. Now, this used to be different because in the past, at least from what I remember of Google Cloud in the earlier days, if you wanted a static IP address, you had to pay for it regardless. And now what the case is that you can reserve external IP addresses for your virtual machines and you can have it not change, meaning it is static, which is great for publicly accessible websites and things of that nature. But as long as the virtual machine is running, you're not billed for it. Once that VM goes off, then you start getting charged for that reserved address. So if you're thinking that you're going to run like a web host from Google Cloud and you want a static IP, just make sure that that thing is always on, because once it goes off, you start getting charged for that. So just something to keep in mind there. So let's see. Skip over the boilerplate stuff for Google. Let's talk about the actual firewall rules now. Now, kind of what I mentioned at the beginning of this segment of videos is that we have the ability and the need to route data from one place to another, right? That's networking basics. That is routing packets from sender to destination. Things will get transformed along the way. We'll hop to different networks and hopefully we'll get to where we need to go. When we talk about routing in Google, we basically have to ensure that our various levels of firewall allow these packets to come in. Now, I'm not necessarily going to go too deep into the actual routing tables because, this is basic. Simple routing, at least I hope, in theory, it should not really be something that you have to deal with too much. You do have the ability to set up routing tables if you would like. Now, I guess I will talk about this for a moment. If you are setting up a router, and if you have never played with this, any device can be a router. You don't necessarily have to go out and buy a Linksys or a Netgear or something like that router. You can technically set up a Linux machine or a Windows machine to act as a router, if you have that available to you. What you're really doing is just telling packets how to get from one network to another and what they have to be transformed into. So if you're taking a packet from the greater internet and bringing it internal, your router is basically going to tell that packet where it needs to go inside that network. So if I see my virtual or my phone here, I have requested google.com. I get data from google.com coming in, and it gets transformed by my router, and it says, go to the IP address that requested it. All right, so this would be my 192.168.1.10 asked for Google's website. Okay, Okay, well, that's where the packets need to go. That's what the router basically does, and the routing table will help you with that. And kind of why I'm going off on this slight tangent is that this is something that you can define inside Google. And if you are setting this up for a corporation or you're setting it up for some kind of a VPN-based architecture where you want people to remote in, like with a VPN client, this is something that you can set up as well. So if I set up a VPN server inside of Google, or really a VPN gateway, I can basically tell packets coming in from the VPN socket connection where they need to be routed in the network. And I can also use this to assign internal IP addresses for the devices connecting in. Slightly different in terms of routing and what we're going over. It's kind of a similar topic, but if we are VPNing into a infrastructure, we need to assign the device coming in via VPN and IP as well. And you can set that as part of this particular construct here. So the firewall is kind of the interesting thing to talk about here. At least I find it interesting because it is serving multiple layers of protection here. So we have the VPC network firewall, and then we have our virtual machine firewalls. Okay, and they're two different firewalls, two different things to be concerned with. I know I mentioned this before in another video, but if you are starting to see issues with your services, say you're running something on a virtual machine, you have to check the local firewall, which is running as part of that operating system, and the VPC firewall. And the VPC firewall is basically your external protection against the greater internet. Okay, and we're going to take a look at that here. One interesting point, though, I guess before I go over there, is that we have an implied deny all ingress and allow all egress. And what this means is that we're blocking everything coming in, and we are allowing everything going out, and that's the default firewall behavior for us. So as part of our firewall here, if we go over to the VPC network, I suppose I should, let's take a quick look at routes first before we go into it. You can see that we have routes that we can create and that we can manage here. So default route to the internet, default route to the subnetwork, default route to the subnetwork. If I were to create a route, I could say route demo. Sure, let's leave it in hacker case. Which network are we going to use? What's the destination IP address range? Are we going to allow precedence for these packets coming in? And then what are the various hops that we're going to go through? Again, this is networking basics, but how do we serve packets from network to network to network? You know, are they going to another gateway, or are they just going straight to their intended destination? But this firewall is kind of what I want to go over here. This is one of the things that you have to deal with if you're dealing with any kind of network-based traffic outside of, you know, the defaults of what we've been using so far. So this page has changed over time, just so that you are aware. When I first started working with Google Cloud for classroom stuff, it did not look like this. It was a lot different. So if it's been a while for you coming into Google Cloud, just be aware things have changed. But that's business as usual, right? So let's call this allow all, because maybe I want to just open up my network to the whole internet. We can log what's triggering this rule. We can pick the network that we're applying this rule to. Again, priority, similar notion. What is the priority of this particular rule? Ingress or egress, allow or deny if we match it. So if you have ever done an IP table setup, what are you doing when you match a chain, basically? So let's say that we have a packet coming into our network. It is coming in on port 80. What do you do with it? Do you allow it to come in? Do you drop it? Do you allow it to pass through? Those are your typical IP tables chain rules. But here we're just saying, is it coming in or is it going out? Are we going to allow it or deny it? Okay. And with that, we can basically specify tags, which gives us a nice way of referencing it. So let's call this HTTP. Did we say we didn't pick the port yet? I can pick a source IP range. So if I am looking for anything, this would be 0000/0. So it's a 0.0.0.0/0. So this is going to check for every single IP address. Or I could look for specific IP address ranges. If I know that this packet is originating from somewhere, like a particular server address or particular VM address or particular computer address, I can allow it or deny it based on what I understand. Typically, you would use this feature if you only want to allow traffic from one particular IP, or if you want to block a range of IPs that you know to be suspicious, for instance. So if I pick 0.0.0.0/0, that's everybody. And then I could say allow port 80 on TCP. TCP, UDP, again, we're not going over in great detail. TCP is your standard internet handshake-based paradigm. UDP, you're not waiting for that handshake. In theory, it's a lot faster, better for game servers, so on and so forth, outside of the scope of this class. But we can allow that. We can also pick other protocols too, if you want. And then we would just create it. And then I would have a new rule on my network here. All lowercase. Allow. Oh, fair enough. So here I'm allowing everything on port 80. Or sorry, I'm denying. I want to allow everything coming in. I could create that. So now I have a new rule which should match. And based on how this thing falls in the priority level, it may have precedence over other rules. Just kind of something to really play with. I'm going to go ahead and delete this because I don't want traffic coming in right now. So we have our rules. We have our firewalls. Make sure that you very clearly set these things because, again, if you're trying to work with external sources, external traffic, this is probably going to be one of the traps that your packets fall into, whether you want them to or not. Okay, so with that, that's kind of enough of an overview, I think, of VPC networks, of how we can set IP address ranges and the firewall. Again, I know I went into the local firewall in another video for setting it in, say, a server. But keep in mind that if you want to play with multiple levels of firewall, which I would highly recommend that you do if you're going into any kind of a production-based environment, it's going to be your firewall D, your UFW, IP tables, Windows security, whichever type of server you're running, make sure you set that firewall up appropriately as well. So you can never have too many layers of security. Anyway, I hope this was useful for you. I will see you all in the next video. Bye, everybody.